tubes along the tube. And here, so you have electron micrographs of different carbon nanotubes, multi-wall, double-wall. This is a multi-wall. This is a single-wall nanotube. You know this already. And also, I think you've seen with Professor Bogoski the way we can characterize the carbon nanotubes, because when you fold, for example, a sheet of paper, there are different ways of folding the sheet of paper. And so you can make different kinds of nanotubes. And to characterize nanotubes, we use lattice and two vectors in the hexagonal. The hexagonal lattice of a graphene sheet, for example, this is the origin, and this is the vector to define the location of points in this lattice. For example, this point has the coordinates 4, minus 5. You go, minus 5 in this direction, and 4 in this direction, and you end up here. And you can define another point, 6, 3. So you can define points in the hexagonal lattice of a graphene sheet. And this way, you can define different kinds of carbon nanotubes. This is, for example, if you consider here a piece of the graphene sheet and with two parallel lines. And when you will roll this sheet to form a carbon nanotube, you can define the point here, which is perpendicular to this line, and form a carbon nanotube, which is characterized by the indices 10, 0, because this point has the coordinate 10, 0 in the hexagonal lattice of this in this frame. Of course, so you can make different kinds of nanotubes, here from the origin to the point 10, 10. And now, you define another kind of nanotubes with a different structure. This is still a single-wall carbon nanotube. I took this on a website, a very nice website, but I forgot to mention. I'm just getting back. Yes, on this website you can find all this information and all these animations. And you can play with the indices and make different carbon nanotubes. Yes, this is a 10 file, which is a chiral carbon nanotube. But I heard that you've already also heard about this kind of carbon nanotubes, and you see here the twist and the chiral nanotubes, which is characterized by the indices 10 and 5. So in fact, you can make different kinds of carbon nanotubes. Well, of course, the nanotubes with small indices are not very stable. In fact, they are not stable, but they start to be stable here. And also, a very interesting property is that these carbon nanotubes exhibit different electronic properties that can be conducting or semiconducting or metallic. They also exhibit different spectroscopic techniques. But all this was discussed earlier during this week. But what I'd like to say is that today, as-produced carbon nanotubes, in fact, are a mixture of all these types of carbon nanotubes. And there's still a big challenge in this field to sort carbon nanotubes, if you want to use them for electronic application, for example, or to control their growth and to control, for example, carbon nanotubes with a well-defined chirality or with a well-defined indices. And today, this is still very difficult and still the topic of very active research. But in fact, I won't talk about these properties because for the mechanical properties or electrical properties I will discuss, we won't pay attention to the exact nature of the carbon nanotubes. So I've shown you single-wall carbon nanotubes, but there are also multi-wall carbon nanotubes with coaxial tubes. So here you see a nice picture of multi-wall carbon nanotubes where you see the several tubes. Very often also single-wall carbon nanotubes are assembled as a form of bundles, which can be a problem for mechanical properties. I will discuss this. But as-produced nanotubes very often form single-wall form this bundle, which is not the case for multi-wall nanotubes. So about synthesis and production, also very briefly for information, there are two main approaches to make carbon nanotubes. The first one consists in the vaporization of a carbon source can be a graphite, for example, at a very high temperature, using, for example, a laser or an electric arc. And when the carbon condenses in the presence of metal nanoparticles, you can observe the growth of carbon nanotubes. So this is a picture with a laser system. So there's the system is vaporized with laser energy, and then it's cooled down on a copper piece of copper, and here you collect the carbon nanotubes. Well, and this kind of techniques, which are called high temperature, because it's about 3,000 degrees, was widely used in the 90s, and in fact, these were the first techniques which were developed to synthesize carbon nanotubes. They can produce very high quality carbon nanotubes. When I mean high quality, that means carbon nanotubes with a very low amount of defect. And but the main the problem with this technique is that these are lab scale techniques, and also that you have production of high quality nanotubes along with a large fraction of impurities. So I would say this is why in the 90s big industrial companies were not so excited and interested in carbon nanotubes. But the situation has changed in the I would say at the beginning of the in 2000 approximately. With new processes to synthesize carbon nanotubes by so-called medium temperature or low temperature synthesis by chemical vapor deposition. Here you use hydrocarbons, for example ethylene is what you use, and you have decomposition of this ethylene at the surface of metal nanoparticles at temperatures which are much lower than with the previous technique. And then you can grow nanotubes, and you can control the growth of nanotubes on substrate, and you can make very nice growth. For example, these are examples taken from the literature. And the also a very interesting advantage of this technique is that it's a scalable technique, and also you have the production of a very small amount of impurities. But the quality of the nanotubes is lower compared to the high temperature. Anyway. But now, so some companies are interested in carbon nanotubes, and I forgot to mention in my introduction that we are working in a public research organization, but in a virtual joint laboratory with a company called Arkema. Arkema is one of the main French chemistry companies, and they are producing carbon nanotubes, as many other companies over the world. But and they use a process which is called the free design bed, where they have the catalyst particles, and there's the gas flow in the system, and you have continuously production of carbon nanotubes, so they are not produced by batch, but continuously, and they collect the nanotubes at the surface of the of particles, which are support for nanoparticles, and the nanotubes grow on top of these particles. And here you see the growth of a of a carbon nanotubes at the surface of a metal nanoparticle. And today, this is, for example, a picture of the Arkema pilot plant. They can produce almost 10 kilograms of carbon nanotubes per day, which is about several tons per year. And they are designing at the moment a bigger plant for producing even more carbon nanotubes. So I would say this, the production of carbon nanotubes was really a challenge. But today, we can say that production of carbon nanotubes is not anymore a problem. It's possible to produce carbon nanotubes on large scale and to really explore their potential application. And there are several potential applications because of the properties of carbon nanotubes. First of all, they are very strong. They also exhibit good electrical conductivity. They can sustain very high current density. They have a high specific area, a high thermal conductivity. They have also specific feature. I don't know if I will have time to discuss this, but their length can change when we vary the density of charges in the carbon nanotubes, which can be useful to make, for example, actuators. And also, they are light. Their density, depending whether we are considering single-wall or multi-wall carbon nanotubes, can vary from 1.3 typically to 1.8 grams per cc. So this is why they are
several anticipated applications for carbon nanotubes, and in particular today I will discuss composite materials. Of course, if we add nanotubes to polymers or to different matrices, we can expect to bring new functionalities or to improve the properties of these matrices. And for example, we can expect to fabricate strong and light composite or anti-static materials for coating or connecting the paints and inks, and more sophisticated application I mentioned already, actuator or sensor, if we have time to discuss them. There's several other applications, but I won't talk about them today. So first, a few words about the mechanical properties of carbon nanotubes. So this is a curve. I will show several times curves of this type, where we see the stress as a function of the strain for a carbon nanotube, but I will show it also for other kinds of materials, but these are similar curves. And in this kind of curve, you get different information. First of all, so I apologize if people are very familiar already with it, but for people who are not yet familiar, I'm still mentioning it. You deduce the slope. From the slope, you deduce the Young's modulus of the material, of the elastic constant. Here, this is the failure of the material. So here you have the strain to failure, and here the stress to failure, or which is usually called the strength of the material. And for carbon nanotubes, the strength exceed 10 GPa, which is why carbon nanotubes are considered as the strongest material on Earth, because 10 GPa for the strength is extremely high. The best commercial carbon fiber, for example, which are the strongest commercially available material, have a strength of about 5-6 GPa. And even in some paper you can find that the strength could be about 50 GPa. Of course, the strength decreases, and the Young's modulus as well, if the nanotubes contain defect. So this is for perfect nanotubes without defect. I would also like to indicate that the strength of the Young's modulus of the carbon nanotubes doesn't depend on the, you know, I've said it in the introduction that there can be different kinds of carbon nanotubes for single wall, depending on different indices, but typically the Young's modulus doesn't strongly depend on these indices. So this is about mechanical properties, and I will show you some simulations from the University of Bonn, which are quite spectacular, because also, I forgot to mention that the Young's modulus for the carbon nanotubes is about 1 terapascal, which means that they are stiff as diamond, for example. They are extremely stiff and strong. And here, you can see a simulation of a deformation of a carbon nanotube under tensile load. And what's really surprising is that the material which is very stiff can be deformed that much. Usually, materials which are stiffer like that are much brittle. Their strain to failure is much smaller than that of carbon nanotubes. And this was for a single wall nanotube. This is for a multi wall. You see also that they can be bent reversibly. So this is a simulation, but these are experimental observations. And again, you have to consider that this material is extremely stiff. Oops, last one, to show you that it's still possible to break the carbon nanotubes. Well, the red indicates the stress, the maximum stress, and here the carbon nanotube is broken. Also, I told you that single-wall carbon nanotubes are often assembled as bundles, as produced carbon nanotubes. And of course, the Young's modulus of a bundle is lower than the Young's modulus of an individual carbon nanotube. It's about 655 GPa, which is already a very large value. But this is why sometimes individual carbon nanotubes could be better in principle for mechanical reinforcement. But because of the formation of these bundles, sometimes it's preferable to use a thin multi-walls as compared to single-wall carbon nanotubes. So, Okay, so we've seen that carbon nanotubes exhibit exciting mechanical properties, but they are also conductive. So they can be used for various applications because of their electrical conductivity, and for very basic applications but very large markets. For example, for the development of antistatic materials, you have in electronics, in cars, almost everywhere. Also conductive inks or paints. For example, for organic electronics, people are looking for the development of conductive inks, or for electromagnetic shielding to protect electronics. There are several other kinds of fillers which are used in polymers or as coatings, but I will show you that the carbon nanotubes exhibit several advantages as compared to these other kinds of fillers which are carbon black. Carbon black are carbon particles which are almost spherical, or metallic particles or conductive polymer are other kinds of fillers which can be used in polymers and for this kind of application. But a big challenge, and this is why I will focus on the processing of carbon nanotubes. Depending on the application you target, the structuration of the carbon nanotube is critical. For example, if you want to make antistatic material, you want a material which is electrically conductive. But also for application, for the cost, and for the processing of the polymer in which you add carbon nanotubes, it's very important to have a small amount of carbon nanotubes. And for this, you will look for the formation of what we call a percolated network. I will talk about in more detail about percolation later. So percolation is the formation of a pathway, continuous pathway throughout the sample, so you can have electrical conductivity in the system. And for this, you need, in fact, disorganization of the carbon nanotubes. You need a random orientation. Because you can intuitively understand that if you have random orientation, you can maximize the contact probability of the carbon nanotubes. Whereas if there would be a line, then the carbon nanotubes, the contact probability is smaller. So for this kind of application, you look for random orientation of carbon nanotubes, so that you can have a low percolation threshold. I will talk about that a bit later. But on the other hand, for mechanical properties, for example, like in classical composites, which are used today with carbon fiber in aeronautics or in sport goods, for example, you want to use the fiber which are well aligned in a well defined direction to have a good reinforcement. This is what is done with the carbon fiber in composites, for example. And for carbon nanotubes, it's the same. If you want to obtain good mechanical properties, the alignment of the nanotube is very important, and also you need a high fraction of carbon nanotubes to have a good mechanical reinforcement. So you see, depending on the application, the structuration of the carbon nanotubes can be completely different, and this is why processing is very important. And it's important and also difficult, and you will understand why it's difficult by looking at this picture. I've shown you very nice schematic of carbon nanotubes. You've seen nice tubes which are straight. But this is what is produced in practice by CVD processes. In fact, you see that we are far from the perfect nanotubes I've shown you in the schematics. In fact, the nanotubes contain structural defects. This is why you observe their waviness, they are entangled, they are also very long. And if you want to process this, you see that it's a problem. So yes, this is on a larger scale, and in these small particles, you have the carbon nanotubes I've shown you, and still on a larger scale, the as-produced carbon nanotubes looks typically like a conventional product. So the main goal of our research is to use this powder, these carbon nanotubes which are completely entangled, and try to find processing to order them and to use them in composite materials. And now I'm going to talk about processing. Yes. Okay, so we've discussed the introduction to carbon nanotubes, and now I will discuss nanotube processing. And because you've, I hope you you've seen that can be this is a challenge and important for the field. So, and also why it's difficult to process carbon nanotubes compared to other materials. First of all, carbon nanotubes cannot be melted as a conventional polymer. If you heat carbon nanotubes at high temperature, you just burn them. They are also almost insoluble in any solvent or at extremely low concentration, so basically this is useless. But still, we have to process carbon nanotubes and to order them if we want to manifest their properties. And for this, we will have to find the ways of dispersing nanotubes in liquid and use liquid processing, which is a very convenient processing. For this, we can use high shear mixing, sonication, to try to disentangle the carbon nanotubes, to cut them also, because they are entangled. If we can cut them, it's easier to control their organization. And we have also to pay attention to the interaction between the carbon nanotubes to avoid their aggregation or to promote their aggregation, depending on what kind of application we are looking for. And for this, there are different approaches. The carbon nanotubes, which are the filler, can be directly included in polymers, which are melted, or they can be dispersed in solvents, which are mixed with polymers. Basically, we have to go through liquid steps in order to process the material and to end up with a composite material. And because carbon nanotubes cannot be dissolved or melted, so we have to modify the interface of carbon nanotubes so they can be dispersed in different solvents. And there are different approaches which are explored over the world by different groups. For example, we can use so-called non-covalent functionalization with the absorption of polymer or surfactant. I will talk about that. We can also graft, covalently graft molecules at the interface of carbon nanotubes. It's also possible to have a strong interaction between molecules which contain phenyl groups with carbon nanotubes, and they interact through peace-taking interaction. These are strong attractive interactions in order to make carbon nanotubes dispersible or soluble in different solvents. I won't talk about other approaches. And here I'm showing you some examples. For example, I told you that carbon nanotubes cannot be dissolved. This is true for all carbon nanotubes, but you can modify the carbon nanotubes. And this is, for example, something which has been developed by a colleague in Bordeaux. He reduced carbon nanotubes by the addition of cations, for example, lithium or potassium, and he makes nanotube salt, for example, lithium, for one lithium ion, there's a certain number of carbon atoms. And this salt, you will see, in a polar solvent, can be dissolved. If I can show you the movie. Here, my colleague Alain Pinicot is adding a droplet of polar organic solvent on top of this salt, nanotube salt, and you observe the spontaneous dissolution of the carbon nanotubes. And this would be completely impossible without reducing the carbon nanotubes. You will just see the piece of powder in the... So that's a way to have a dispersion of carbon nanotubes. And here also what's interesting is that you see it's not using any mixer, any sonication. They spontaneously dissolve. This is why there's something also important, and I think this during this lecture it's an opportunity to clarify a few words, because sometimes it's confusing in the literature. This is a solution, it's not a dispersion. It's a solution a system which is thermodynamically stable. It's exactly like the dissolution of salt or sodium chloride. It's not a colloidal dispersion which is metastable. It's a solution. And also similar system, related system, which are completely different, have been developed at Rice University, where Matteo Pasquali and his group, they dissolve carbon nanotubes in super acids. The carbon nanotubes are protonated, and again, can be dissolved in super acids. Super acids are a mixture of sulfuric acid and chlorosulfonic acids. All this is nice, because it's a spontaneous dissolution, it's a thermodynamic equilibrium, no mechanical energy is needed to dissolve the carbon nanotubes, and we can dissolve them at high concentration. But they have limitation because for this method you have to first modify with some chemistry and heavy chemistry the carbon nanotubes, and also you have to, it's only possible in a certain number of solvents, and you have to work under inert atmosphere. Here you have to avoid moisture, for example, and here you have to avoid, you have to work in glove boxes to avoid the oxidation of the carbon nanotubes. So, another approach to make a nanotube solution consists in grafting molecules at the interface of the carbon nanotubes. For example, you can use carbon nanotubes with nitric acid. You get the formation of carboxylic groups at the interface of the carbon nanotubes. And from these carboxylic groups, you can graft any kind of molecules so that you can make nanotubes dispersible in almost any solvent, depending on what you graft on the carbon nanotubes. You can also keep the nanotubes like that. They become hydrophilic because of the presence of the carboxylic groups, and they can be dispersed, dissolved, this is again a dissolution, dissolved in water. But the disadvantage of this technique is that when you graft with a covalent bond carboxylic groups, you alter, of course, the pi electron network of the carbon nanotubes, and you alter the properties of the carbon nanotubes. So there's finally another approach, which is probably the one which is the most widely used, which consists in making nanotube dispersion by using the adsorption of dispersion, which can be a surfactant or polymer, and by supplying mechanical energy. These systems are metastable, as opposed to the system I've shown you. For example, you can use surfactants, which are adsorbed at the interface of the carbon nanotubes. The surfactants make the nanotubes hydrophilic. They also form micelle in the bulk. You can adsorb also polymers. And these are again examples of surfactants adsorbed at the interface of the carbon nanotubes. I'm saying that these systems are metastable because, like in conventional colloids which are stabilized with surfactant, the stable state is not this state. The stable state would be the state where the carbon nanotubes would touch each other because of a very strong van der Waals interaction. But the carbon, the polymers or the surfactant, they provide a kinetic a barrier, and they against this aggregation, and this is why these materials are kinetically stable, but it's not thermodynamic stability. So you start from the powder, you add surfactant, but without mechanical energy, because here there's no spontaneous dissolution, because the carbon nanotubes, the stable state, is a phase separation of the nanotubes from the solvent. But if you provide mechanical energy, sonication for example, you cut the nanotubes, you disentangle them, and you disperse them. It's exactly the same for various kinds of colloids, and I'm taking an example of a system which is well known, for example, emulsions. Emulsions are mixtures of oil and water, so again, I apologize for people who are familiar with emulsions. And so you know that oil and water do not mix, but it's possible to make metastable mixtures by using surfactant. If you add a surfactant to systems that contain oil and water, you form droplets, oil droplets, which are stabilized by surfactant molecules adsorbed at the interface of the oil droplet. Because in the surfactant, so you have an aliphatic chain and a polar head. So this is why the surfactant gets adsorbed at the interface of the oil droplet. And this surfactant induces repulsive interaction between the droplet. But again, the stable state would be the full phase separation of oil and water to minimize the surface energy. Because when you form this particle, of course, you form a lot of surface. And because of the surface energy, the system is not in a stable state, but it's in a metastable state, stabilized by the repulsive interaction provided by surfactant chains. And so now, in fact, nanotubes are nothing special compared to other kinds of colloidal particles. They are like emulsions. I will show some differences, but most of the behavior is really similar. And it would be similar for gold nanorods, for gold nanoparticles. This is just physical chemistry of nanoparticles or colloidal particles. So when you have particles in a solvent, and they interact with, this is the interaction potential as a function of the separation between the particle. You can have repulsion at short range or attraction depending on the nature of the of what's absorbed at the interface. And depending on this interaction, exactly like from molecular systems, you can observe different kinds of behavior. For example, if the particles repel each other, they tend to be dispersed, homogeneously dispersed, and because of to maximize entropy, they are dispersed in the system, and they form a single phase. It's exactly like molecules or gas molecules in a container. But now, if you have interaction, attractive interaction between the particles, and I would say weak interaction, you can observe, like in a molecular system, phase separation, liquid gas separation or solid gas separation. It's exactly similar to molecular system. And when you have interaction which are much stronger than KT, where KT is the term thermal energy, you can have different behavior with the formation of gels, which are not at thermal equilibrium. But because the strength of the interaction is so strong, that when the particles stick to each other, they don't move anymore, because of the energy which is involved, the thermal energy is not sufficient to separate the particle and so that the particle can stick and exhibit Brownian motion. So you can observe all this in colloidal systems. And yes, so, and all this kind of behavior is controlled by the interaction between the colloidal particle. And it's exactly the same for carbon nanotubes or for other particles you would like to use. So this is why it's important to control the interaction between the particles. So this is why I will say a few words about interaction between colloidal particles. So first of all, I'm taking sphere as example, but it's true for rods, for plates, for any kind of particle. Except that the form, the exact form will be different depending on the shape of the particle. First of all, all particles, all material experience van der Waals attraction. These are ubiquitous interaction. And for two spheres, for example, this is the equation that describes the attractive interaction, van der Waals interaction for two spheres, where R is the radius of the sphere, D is the separation between the sphere, and A is called the Amaker's constant, which depends on the nature of the material. And so this is the classical van der Waals attraction. And because this attraction is ubiquitous, that means that to stabilize colloidal particles or carbon nanotubes in solvent, we need some repulsion. Otherwise, any colloidal system would not exist without repulsive interactions. Or at least they would not be dispersed. And for this, there are different kinds of repulsive interaction which can be used to stabilize carbon nanotubes. First of all, we can have adsorption of polymers at the interface of the particles. And this polymer can provide what we call a steric interaction, because you can intuitively guess that when two particles are approaching each other, you are limiting the possible conformation of the polymer, and this is why the polymer can have more space, and this is why there's a steric repulsion or anthropic repulsion between the colloidal particle provided by the adsorbed polymer chains. Also, a very common way of inducing repulsion between colloidal particles is to use charges at the interface of the colloidal particle, so that you can have electrostatic repulsion between the particles. And this electrostatic repulsion depends on the concentration of salt in the system. I'm not going into all the detail of this electrostatic repulsion, but it approximately scales as an exponential, where K, this is D is the separation between the particle, and 1 over K is length, which is called the Debye length, and the Debye length decreases with increasing the salt concentration. So that means that the Debye length typically describes the range of the electrostatic repulsion. And when you add salt, you screen, in fact, the charges at the interface, and the electrostatic repulsion becomes shorter range. This is why you can have different behavior depending on the concentration of salt. For example, and this was developed several decades ago, in the 40s or in the 50s, by and it's known as the DLVO model by Deryagin, Lando, Verbe, and Overbeek, to describe the colloidal stability, the stability of colloids. For example, when there's so this is electrostatic repulsion, this is the van der Waals attraction, and to get the total potential of interaction, you just sum these two contributions, and depending on the salt concentration, I told you, you can vary the range of the electrostatic repulsion, and you can have different behavior. For example, at this is a typical shape of an interaction potential with here an attraction wealth, here a kinetic barrier. But here you can see on this plot what happens when you increase the salt concentration. When the salt concentration is low, there's a repulsion, so the particles are stable. When you increase the salt concentration, the electrostatic repulsion gets shorter range. This is why the repulsion now is at shorter range. And if you keep increasing the salt concentration, you see the barrier which is decreasing. And finally, the barrier is not sufficient to stabilize the particles against the aggregation. This is why if you add salt to a colloidal dispersion, you will observe the aggregation of the colloidal particles. And I mentioned another interaction which is very common and which is you will see which is important for carbon nanotubes, which is called the depletion attraction. The depletion attraction takes place when you have a mixture of big particles and small particles. Here I'm considering big spheres, and which are embedded in a solution where there are smaller spheres. These smaller spheres can be polymer coils or surfactant micelles, for example. And this can be emulsion droplets, colloidal particles, carbon nanotubes, bigger particles. And when you approach them, you see that when they are close enough, there's no room in between for the particles to fit in between the two particles. As a result, there's the osmotic pressure of the small particle which is not compensated in between the particles. And this creates an effective attractive interaction between the particles. And this attractive interaction is known as a depletion attraction. So it's a way to induce a small interaction and weak interaction with attractive interaction between colloidal particles. And also the nice thing with depletion attraction is that you can very easily control them by just controlling the concentration of the small particle in the solution. Because I told you it's proportional to the osmotic pressure, so it's proportional to the concentration of the small particle. So you have more particle, you have stronger depletion attraction, and so on. So this is a formula for sphere. It was, you see, there's nothing new in this. I'm just recalling basic things in the field. It's due to Asakura and Ozawa in 58. But it can be also the same for carbon nanotubes. If carbon nanotubes which are stabilized with surfactant micelles, if they are close enough, they will experience as well this depletion attraction. Okay. And now, if you remind, and this will be the last slide before the break, if you remind the slide I've shown you in the introduction, I've shown you people who were assembling particles to make metamaterials. They were assembling this kind of particles. And what do they use to assemble these particles? They just add, I don't remember if these are very small latex particles or micelles, anyway. They just add small particles to induce depletion attraction and to induce the aggregation of these small rods, which then are deposited, these doublets are deposited on the surface, and this material exhibits interesting optical properties. But it was to show you that this kind of processing can be useful to process material for optical application or metamaterials. And I think we'll take a break now.
Other questions?
You can understand or predict the phase diagram again exactly like for molecular or atomic system. This is a very simple system. For example, the liquid gas transition of a system. This is a free energy as a function of the density. At high temperature, this is a free energy. You are here, you have a single phase. And the free energy, when you lower the temperature, changes and you have the critical point. And at lower temperature, you have a phase separation between a turbulent phase and a more concentrated phase. And here, if you draw a tangent line, you can deduce the concentration of the gas or the liquid in the system. It's exactly the same for colloidal particles. Yes. For example, this is an example of liquid gas transition for emulsion droplet, where you see that when there's a little amount of surfactant, that means that there's a little amount of micelles, so they are very weak attractive interaction. The particles are homogeneously dispersed, it's like a gas. But when you increase the attractive interaction, you observe a phase separation with the formation of a more denser phase with a higher concentration of emulsion droplets, which are in equilibrium, you see here, small droplets which remain dispersed. So, and you have exchanges regularly between these more concentrated parts and these more dilute parts. So this is typically like a gas solid, liquid gas phase transition in a colloidal system. And so for carbon nanotubes, what do we observe when we vary the interaction between the carbon nanotubes? I would say we observe similar things. For example, this is an optical micrograph of a carbon nanotube suspension, of course, because which are stabilized with a surfactant. The surfactant is sodium dodecyl sulfate, which form micelles. It's called SDS. And when the nanotubes are stabilized by this surfactant, of course, we don't see the carbon nanotubes because the optical resolution of an optical microscope is not sufficient to observe these nanoparticles, but we observe an homogeneous texture, which means that the nanotubes are dispersed. But when we add surfactant at higher concentration, we have attractive interaction and we observe the formation of a texture with the carbon nanotubes which form a more concentrated phase. So we can say, well, that all this is very simple. Carbon nanotubes and emulsion are similar, and they are similar to molecular system, and everything is simple and can be understood. But in fact, there are some differences, and I will discuss these differences. Again, a few words about the experimental system which is used here. But we could, in principle, observe the same with other kinds of particles. It has nothing specific to carbon nanotubes. So it's carbon nanotubes are dispersed in water and they are stabilized by SDS, the surfactant. And as I told you, the attractive interaction between the nanotubes can be fine-tuned by just changing the concentration of surfactant. And in fact, we can vary by a very small fraction of KT the interaction between the carbon nanotubes. And if we look for a given concentration of carbon nanotubes, the behavior of the system, so this is at low surfactant concentration, there are no depletion attraction. When we increase the surfactant concentration, we observe the formation of a texture with the formation of clusters and more dilute system. And this gets more and more pronounced as we increase the surfactant concentration, the clusters become bigger. But this is different from emulsion, because in emulsion system, when you have this equilibrium between clusters and dilute system, you observe a phase separation, and I told you it's equivalent to a phase transition, a liquid gas phase transition. Whereas in carbon nanotubes, we are very surprised, and other authors have observed the same, we don't observe the phase separation. There's no sedimentation, there's no coarsening, because in principle, in the phase separation system, you have the growth of one phase of the domain, and you have at the end a full phase separation. This is not the case in carbon nanotubes. We always observe this texture which remains stable for months without coarsening of the system. There's no macroscopic phase separation. So these states are at equilibrium. So this was initially very surprising. But we think that there's a way to understand this behavior. The first possibility when you observe something like that, in colloidal system, you can say, well, you're not really at equilibrium. It's just you observe this texture which is stable, but it's not equilibrium. It's just because it's a kinetic stability. Just because the system is frozen, the rearrangements are too slow, and this is why you see this kind of behavior. But here, this is not the case, because we observe exchanges of this is moving. There's no picture, but this is a system at equilibrium. It's not a system which is frozen, and people say it's an arrested phase separation or gelation, because this can happen with carbon nanotube or other colloidal systems. But this occurs when there are very strong interactions between the particles. And this is, for example, a simulation of a colloidal gel, where you see all the particles that are stuck, they are not in equilibrium with free particles. This is taken from a website, Dave White at Harvard. And these are experimental pictures of gels, where you see here aggregates of droplets in the presence of very strong interaction. Actually, in this case, there's a large amount of salt. This is why there's aggregation of the particle. But you see there are no free particles in between this cluster. And actually, they form cluster with a structure which is dictated by the kinetic of aggregation. And this is why we talk about diffusion-limited aggregation or diffusion-limited cluster aggregation and things like that. This is another picture with gold nanorod, and they form a fractal aggregate, and we heard about fractal system for metamaterials earlier this week, and I don't know if assembling gold particles this way could be useful for optical application. But anyway, we are not in this case, but because this case is a system which we can call a gelation. Okay, sometimes people call also this kinetic percolation, but I'd like also again, because this is the opportunity of a lecture to clarify some terms, percolation is not a kinetic concept. So we understand what means kinetic percolation, that's the formation of a continuous network driven by strong interaction, and because you have a formation of a continuous network. But it's not true percolation, because percolation is a statistical concept and not a kinetic concept. So we have to be careful with the terms. And also, the percolation, the formation of such a network, connecting network, is not a phase separation, it's a topological transition. Nothing happens to the free energy when the system percolates, as opposed to the phase transition for the liquid gas. I've shown you here. The free energy is really changing the shape when there's a phase transition. This is not the case when there's a percolation. The percolation is just the formation of a network in the system. And what we call the percolation threshold is the critical concentration at which this continuous pathway can be formed. Because at low concentration, you have isolated clusters. When you increase the concentration, you have bigger clusters, and at a given concentration, you have a continuous cluster. And if you measure the conductivity of a composite material which exhibits this behavior, you will have at low concentration, because the clusters are disconnected, and if the matrix is insulating, there's no electrical conduction, and for the percolation threshold, the conductivity increases sharply, at the threshold, which is here, and you will see that this is very important for application of carbon nanotubes. So, and in this case, I will show you that this can be understood as a percolation behavior. This is not a phase transition; it's a percolation behavior. induced by attractive interaction. So first of all, a few words about the percolation of rows. So this is known for a long time or so. When there are no interactions between the particles, so we just have to consider geometrical effect, which we call the excluded volume. The excluded volume around the road is a volume in which a particle, another road, cannot enter without touching the first road. And so this volume depends on the diameter of the road, of their length, and also depend on the angle on that in between the rows. And of course, so if you have a random distribution, you take an average of this of the sinus of this angle. But and you see that if you have rows which are parallel, this angle is very small, and you decrease the excluded volume. And it was shown by Balberg and also by Hansager that in fact the percolation threshold, the critical concentration for the formation of this network, is given by L times D squared over the excluded volume. And if we have particles with a very large aspect ratio, with a very long length and a very small diameter, you see that we can forget this term and keep only the last one. And basically, the percolation threshold scale as D diameter over L. And this is why carbon nanotubes are very interesting, because carbon nanotubes have a very high aspect ratio. That means that this number is very small, and this means that you can form a conductive pathway for a very low concentration, compared to sphere, for example, or other conductive fillers. And this is why, for example, big companies like Arkema or Bayer in Germany or several others in Asia are very interested in carbon nanotubes, because with a small amount of carbon nanotubes, you can get a percolated network and you can make an insulating polymer matrix conductive just by adding a small amount of carbon nanotubes. And this is why carbon nanotubes are interesting for making antistatic material, transparent conductive films, paints, electromagnetic shielding. In the literature, you can find several reports where the percolation threshold is below 1%, which is very low as compared to other additive fillers. So now, I've shown you a system where we were playing with the attractive interaction by adding surfactant micelles. And what's the effect of attractive interaction on the percolation threshold? The answer is not obvious at all, because intuitively, we can expect that attractive interaction can promote the aggregation of the carbon nanotubes, and this way they can lower the percolation threshold. This has been reported for sphere already, and this has been shown also experimentally for sphere. But for roads, the question is still open: the effect of attractive interaction on the behavior, on the percolation behavior of roads. So you say that, well, that's intuitively easy, because attractive interaction will promote the formation of cluster and thereby the percolation. But also you can say that if you have attraction between the particle, then the rows will tend to align parallel to each other because of this attractive interaction. And I told you that if the particle align parallel to each other, you will decrease the excluded volume. And if you decrease the excluded volume, you will increase the percolation threshold. So, and actually, in the literature, you can find both. Some people claim that interaction raises the percolation threshold of roads, and some other claims that it lowers the percolation threshold. But these are only theoretical investigation. And these are two examples from the literature by Grzycik and co-workers. By computational analysis, they deduce that attractive interaction increase the percolation of rows. Here you see the percolation threshold as a function of some parameter in their simulation, but this is for interacting single wall carbon nanotubes, and this is for non-interacting carbon nanotubes. So the percolation threshold is greater with attractive interaction. But more recently, also, Tania Schilling and co-workers reported, also by doing simulation, that depletion-induced percolation, the percolation threshold can be decreased
by depletion-induced attraction between the rods. So you see, it's not, the answer is not obvious. So what about experiments? Oh yeah, and we can also refer to even older theoretical work, which is general and which is not meant only for carbon nanotubes, but for any kind of particles or even magnetic system. This was developed by Koenig Liu and co-workers initially. They study the formation of physical clusters of atoms, and they study the effect of interaction on the formation of these clusters. And these are distribution of clusters at equilibrium. Again, I'm not talking about kinetic system or kinetic gelation. All this is thermodynamical equilibrium. So they've calculated the distribution of clusters of interacting particles, and they deduce for dilute systems that the percolation threshold should scale as 1 over the average of this exponential, where beta is again the thermal energy, 1 over beta actually, and U, they took U as a sticky potential. That means that the particle experience U when they touch each other, and 0 interaction when they don't each other. And from this, of course, you see that if you have attracting interaction, of course, the percolation threshold will be lower. And this has been observed for spheres, experimentally. So now the question is experiments for road. I've shown you that with carbon nanotubes, we can observe this kind of phenomena. So more quantitatively, yes. Yeah, I've shown you already this slide, so you know already all this information. But we can detect the percolation by just characterizing the system with a dielectric spectroscopy, for example, because a nanotube suspension can be considered as a complex electric circuit where you have a resistor and less resistive part in the solvent. So you have capacitive contribution due to the formation of the clusters. The clusters act as the plates of the capacitors, and they can be polarized. And in fact, when you measure the current, when you apply an electrical field, you have the real part, which is the electrical conductivity, and the imaginary part, which is the dielectric constant, which depend on the presence of this capacitor, so which depend on the presence of the cluster. And when you approach the percolation, you form very large clusters, which with a very high capacitance, and you will observe a very high increase, you expect a high increase of the dielectric constant. And above the percolation threshold, they are short in this cluster, and the dielectric constant drops down. And this is experimentally what is observed, with here the increase of the dielectric constant. When we increase the attractive interaction, because we induce the formation of clusters, and here, when the concentration of surfactant is too high, there's a decrease of the dielectric constant with the percolation threshold here. And this is for a given concentration of carbon nanotubes. At very low concentration, this picture is for very low concentration, there's not enough surfactant to disperse the carbon nanotubes. This is why you observe still pieces of the raw powder, but we can forget this. And if we perform the same experiment for different concentration of carbon nanotubes, we observe that the attractive interaction lowers the percolation threshold. Yeah, this is our experiment, for example. When we increase the surfactant concentration, and here, these points are the decrease of the percolation threshold. And these are lines deduced from the model by Koenig Liu and co-worker, but which has, that we have adapted for Rose. But so I told you that we just have to calculate this quantity, which is here. Yes, which is here by considering well, the volume, the different angles, and so on. And so we can deduce the percolation threshold as a function of the energy of stickiness, if you want. And for this, we consider a term, W pair, which corresponds to the addition between two nanotubes which are perpendicular. And of course, we have to multiply by the right contact area, this term, to integrate over all the possible configuration of two nanotubes which are close to each other. But in fact, we are lucky because this calculation was already performed in another context, because this is in fact correspond to the calculation of the second virial coefficient for polymers. I'm not going into detail, but this was calculated already in the literature for polymers for other purposes. And in fact, in this model, there are only two parameters, which is the stickiness of the nanotubes and the dimension of the carbon nanotubes. And now, if we try to fit the data, of course, there are only 3 points because the experiments are very tedious and it's difficult to have a large number of points. But still, it's not possible to fit the data with any number. For example, if we take an aspect ratio of 200, we see that we are far from the experimental point. If we take an aspect ratio of 800, we are far from the experimental point. Typically, for 400, it's okay. So we have approximately an aspect ratio of 400. We can also deduce the stickiness of the carbon nanotubes, which depend on the surfactant concentration, because I told you that the depletion attraction is proportional to the concentration of surfactant. So we can also deduce the stickiness of the nanotubes. And finally, we can deduce from all these fields also the diameter, because the stickiness depends on the contact area of the carbon nanotubes, and the diameter of the nanotubes, which should be 3 nanometers. So I'm not saying that these are exact numbers, because there are several assumptions in these models. But the numbers are reasonable, and this means that this scenario is reasonable. And, okay. Yes, but what I would just like to say that, so here in fact we have, yeah, this is not a phase separation. We don't observe phase separation of the carbon nanotubes. It's just a percolation induced by a depletion attraction. And the percolation threshold is lowered by the carbon nanotubes. And in this integration, there are two terms, one which, excuse me, the first one corresponds to the integration over the orientation of the particle, and the second one to the integration over the length of the carbon nanotubes. And in fact, one term becomes dominant when the stickiness becomes large, this term becomes dominant. That means that in fact, we would expect the formation of network with nanotubes which are parallel to each other and still with a lower percolation threshold. So I told you when I started discussing the percolation that in principle, with attractive interaction, if the nanotubes will be parallel, we should expect an increase of the percolation threshold. But in fact, it's not the case. And this is counterintuitive because we can still have nanotubes which can be parallel to each other and still a lower percolation threshold. So this is a schematic of what can happen. For weak interaction, the nanotubes are not parallel to each other, but they have a higher percolation threshold. There are more particles here than here. Okay. And this can be interesting because if the nanotubes are in this configuration, the contacts between the nanotubes, the electrical contacts between the nanotubes can be much better. Because in composite materials of carbon nanotubes, the resistivity or the conductivity of the material is essentially limited by the contact between the nanotubes. It's not limited by the nanotubes because the nanotubes, they exhibit a very high electrical conductivity, but all the resistivity is lost in the contact between the carbon nanotubes. So if we have better contacts with the nanotubes, that's a way to improve the electrical properties of composite materials. And in addition to this, if we can lower the percolation threshold and get better contacts, that's even better news. So this is just to show you that by controlling self-assembly, by